Good morning, everyone. Well, I hope you had a chance to write down some of that information if you'd like to volunteer at the pregnancy center here in town. Otherwise, we can get that information, maybe have it available in the bulletin next week for helping to volunteer down there. Speaking of volunteering, if you have your bulletins and you notice on the inside, we got some things coming up over the next few weeks and ongoing every Sunday, of course. Jennifer still needs some help I think, preschool church. The big announcement there in the red letters on the inside of your bulletin, the preschool church could use 3 or 4 helpers. So we still need some help there. Please consider talking to Jennifer about that. And I think we still also need some help on our vacation Bible school. That will be July 12th through 16th. That's also on the inside of your bulletin, the Mystery Island. And so please consider helping out in both of these ministries. That would be greatly, greatly appreciated. So just a couple other announcements. I think tonight we will have service, and we will have choir practice at 4:30 and service at 6 o'clock. Just in case, so you don't make a special trip in, we didn't have church last week, so don't come. Okay? That's just for a couple of you. This Wednesday at 6 p.m., of course, we'll have a regular Bible study, but also I think that's correct. No, it's not correct. It will be a fellowship this Wednesday. I have to look down here at the boss and make sure I'm getting the right stuff. You just keep doing that until I get something wrong. We'll have a cold food fellowship. I said cold food. She goes, like, you know, like sandwiches and salads and stuff like that. Okay, cold food fellowship. I'm generally not the one that has to, I just eat it. So, cold food fellowship. So bring your sandwich stuff and sides, etc. And that'll be at 6 p.m. on Wednesday evening. Any other announcements or anything that we are missing? Please keep in prayer all the folks that are sick, that are ill, can't be here today. The reasons why we kind of shut things down last week. Just a lot of folks falling ill all at the same time from here in our fellowship, and so we wanted to take an abundance of precautions last week, and there are still some that are recovering, those that are healing, several that have been in the hospital and are home or on the way home now, and just continue to pray for all of them as they continue to recover. If there are no other announcements, let's go ahead and open in prayer this morning, and then we'll begin with our song service. Father, we just thank you for this day and all that you've done for us, Lord. We just lift up this time to you and this service. And Lord, may your spirit be here amongst us, or two or three are gathered together in your name. Lord, we just lift it all up to you and this worship time, and may all that we do here be done to your honor and glory. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. So let's begin this morning. If we turn to hymn 804, let's go ahead and stand. Battle Hymn of the Republic. So we didn't get to have service last week and celebrate Memorial Day, so we're going to do it today. And you know what? June 6th happens to be a pretty good date also to celebrate that. June 6th, 1944, 77 years. You all probably remember, and I'll talk about this a little bit later, but you all probably remember, if you were alive at the time, you probably remember where you were on that date. So as we remember our fallen and our heroes in this country, let's sing a few of the songs about that. Battle Hymn of the Republic, 804.
Thank you. How many of you have been noticing the sign or read the sign out there every Sunday? Of course, it's there off and on. About 3 or 4 weeks ago, what did it say? Jesus said, "You can do nothing without me." Have we learned that? Are we learning that? The very fact that we're here today is proof of that, because the Bible says every breath we breathe comes from Him. So we're here because He wants us here. And He wants us to be taught and incentivized to serve Him. And we have that privilege now in giving. And it's not just offering goes around every Sunday, but it's a purpose that we deal with in our hearts, to give unto Him what He wants us to give, what He wants you to give. And then He will bless and He will use it. Let's pray. Certainly, Lord, we are so thankful that we live in America. More of Your grace has been bestowed upon us than we ever deserved. But we thank You, we have this tremendous privilege. And with that privilege, of course, we have responsibilities. And Lord, we pray that You'll lay it upon our hearts that we should do exactly what You want us to do. And we have an offering to take and to receive so that Your work might progress, both here and on the foreign field. And we realize that all of us can have a part in that, regardless of how large or not very large an offering, yet we can do that to worship You and glorify You. And we just pray that You will deal with us accordingly. And then, Lord, pray for Kevin. You will bless and use his message and the word that You give so that it might move us for You and that You might have all glory and praise. Thank You for the privilege of giving for You, to You, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's take our Bibles. Thank you, Orchestra, by the way. I was just sitting there thinking, okay, maybe I need to go home and rework this message because I want to preach on that. But I'll stick with what I got. That was a fantastic song. Jesus is the cornerstone. Let's turn to the book of Joshua. Let's stand and read from Joshua chapter 4. We'll read the first 7 verses. Joshua chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. And it came to pass, when all the people were clean passed over Jordan, that the Lord spake unto Joshua, saying, Take you 12 men out of the people, out of every tribe a man, and command ye them, saying, Take you hence out of the midst of Jordan, out of the place where the priest's feet stood firm, 12 stones. And ye shall carry them over with you, and leave them in the lodging place where ye shall lodge this night. Then Joshua called the 12 men whom he had prepared of the children of Israel, out of every tribe a man. And Joshua said unto them, Pass over before the ark of the Lord your God into the midst of Jordan, and take ye up every man of you a stone upon his shoulder, according unto the number of the tribes of the children of Israel, that this may be a sign among you, that when your children ask their fathers in time to come, saying, What mean ye by these stones? Then ye shall answer them, that the waters of Jordan were cut off before the ark of the covenant of the Lord. When it passed over Jordan, the waters of Jordan were cut off, and these stones shall be a memorial unto the children of Israel forever. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for your word, and we thank you for this opportunity to open it, to study it, Lord, to learn more about you. And Lord, just guide and direct us throughout this time. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. The end of that video says, we will not forget. And that's really kind of the whole point, isn't it? Why we have a Memorial Day. So we do not forget. And that's really the message this morning. If we look at Joshua 4, it's about not forgetting. So let me ask you a question this morning as we begin. How's your memory? I shouldn't ask that question. Do you remember the name of the person sitting next to you? Then you're all right. All right. Our memories fail, don't they? Our memories get fuzzy. Our memories get blurry. We sometimes even remember things not as they were, but how we wish them to be, or how we wish them to have been. Sometimes we can't remember what we had for breakfast, but we can remember what happened 50 years ago, at a specific moment, at a specific hour, on a specific day. We remember with great clarity and detail. If I said a certain date, December 6, 1941, Pearl Harbor. If you were alive that day, you probably remember where you were at. And you probably remember hearing that news. If you were alive, as we said, on June 6, 1944, you probably remember hearing that news of D-Day. Or later on the next year, VE Day, VJ Day. You probably remember those things. If I said September 11th, 2001, you probably remember that morning with great clarity. If I said a date like November 21st, 1963, you would probably remember where you were at the moment you heard of President Kennedy's assassination. But you don't remember what you had for breakfast. Memory has a funny thing, a funny way of working when it comes to that. And it's not so much selectiveness. There's a certain thing that it ingrains in us, in our brains, to remember things of importance. But even then, sometimes we need a good, healthy reminder of things that are important. And God understood this in his people, that they needed reminders. And Joshua is given a way to remind the people of Israel in chapter 4, verses 1 through 7, and the next following verses as well, about how to remind his people on those things that are important. When we look at Memorial Day here in America, we do this to remember. And what we remember is important, and how we remember is important. We learn some things by rote, some things by visualizing things, by seeing monuments, seeing memorials, seeing even the things that seem just completely, I want to say ubiquitous, they're just everywhere. The American flag, for instance, and the things that it represents and symbolizes. These are important for us to remember who we are and how we got here. And Memorial Day, last Monday, we celebrate, we honor people. And it's important for us to remember why. And we see it throughout Scripture, the why it's important and how we should remember those things that are important. I just want to take you on a brief journey here hopefully this will work. Shannon, there we go. Got it. If I showed you this picture, what's the first thing you think of? And it might be a different answer. I'm not giving you the right answers here. What does somebody say something? George Washington.
Seeking divine guidance.
Okay. Godly leadership. At the very inception of our country, where does this take place? Valley Forge. This is so common to us, and we know what it means, but it has so much meaning that maybe some of it escapes us. The father of our country, the leader of our country, the Revolutionary War, and he's seeking God for guidance. Crossing the Delaware. It envisions, it evokes emotions in us of determination, of a fighting spirit, of a will to win at all costs. Does anybody remember what date, what month and day this happened on? I don't remember the year, or else I'd say it. December 25th. This was Christmas Day, and they are crossing the Delaware in freezing cold through the ice in order to get across the river and take the mercenary Hessians by surprise. This was guts and grit and determination. And that's what evokes, that's the emotions that it evokes from me when I see a picture like that. The signing of the Declaration. I think we might know that date. Again, grit, determination, a will to not just win like we'd see in the George Washington pictures, but a will to ensure freedom for the people that they speak for. Might have to click it for me, Shannon. Iwo Jima. Very much the same. If I had thought about it ahead of time, I'd have had a picture in here of D-Day. What about other pictures, other monuments? We can talk about paintings and pictures like we just looked at. We can talk about art that evokes those memories. Music, we just sang several songs. I don't know about you, but it takes me back in time, singing those songs, singing them in school, learning about our country and singing those songs. And then we look at monuments. We see pictures of the Washington Monument. We see pictures of the, go ahead, Shannon, the Lincoln Memorial. And we we can't help but think about the things that those monuments represent. What about the next one? Vietnam War Memorial. The next one. Pearl Harbor. And the things that those are meant to help us to remember. When it comes to the Washington Monument, everything that George Washington was and who he was, Lincoln, the freeing of the slaves, Vietnam Memorial, all of the heroes who died in service of their country, Pearl Harbor, same thing. We look at so many other examples. You drive down highways and they are given names in honor and in memory of certain people or certain events, certain groups of people. Schools are named after presidents, war heroes. You could probably dig in your pocket right now and find a coin or two that would have memorial to somebody or something. Airports you fly out of. O'Hare Airport in Chicago is named after Butch O'Hare, a World War II hero who died in battle. Then we also look at these. What does that evoke from you? When we look at each of these, and there's 1,000 of these pictures like this. These cemeteries all over America and in Europe of American dead. Sacrifice. We look at this flag up here, and we see the stars, we see the blue field, we see the red and white stripes. We even see the parts that aren't part of the flag, the eagle up on top, and the things that those each represent. They are there to call us to remembrance. All of these symbols. And we see the exact same thing throughout Scripture. We see in Joshua. We see stones put together, both in the river and later on on the side, where they encamp after they cross the Jordan. And the purpose of these, it says, is to what? Remember. Remember what God did for his people. Remember what God did for his people. We look at Genesis 28, 18 and 19, and here we see Jacob at Bethel. It says, and Jacob rose up early in the morning and took the stone that he had put for his pillows and set it up for a pillar and poured oil upon the top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel. What had just happened in Genesis 28? Jacob's dream and a stairway, a ladder to heaven, and angels ascending and descending. This is where Jacob received God's promise and a glimpse that God was working in him. And he called the place Bethel, the house of God. God dwells here. We look a few chapters later in 31. Jacob is fleeing from his father-in-law Laban. It says, now therefore come thou, let us make a covenant, I and thou, and that it be for a witness between me and thee. And Jacob took a stone and set it up for a pillar. And Jacob said unto his brother, and gather stones. And they took stones and made a heap. And they did eat there upon the heap. They took this big pile of stones. And what was it for? It was a boundary marker. It was to remember. You ever find one of those little property pins on the corner of your property? Maybe you've done a survey and you had one placed there, or you found an old stone marker that signified a corner from an old survey. Those are to remember where the border is between me and thee. This is what Jacob and Laban are doing. They are saying, here is the boundary. I will cross no further north, you will come no further south. And that will be our border. And this is for us to remember. We look at 1 Samuel all the way up to the time of Samuel and Saul. And we see in 1 Samuel 7, The men of Israel went out of Mizpah and pursued the Philistines and smote them until they came unto Beth-kar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it between Mizpah and Shen and called the name of it Ebenezer, saying, "Hitherto hath the Lord helped us." Israelites had just undergone decades of oppression by the Philistines, and this was their first victory in years against the Philistines. And Samuel sets up a stone to remember that says what? God helped us. God did this. He beat the Philistines. Then there's the other side of the stone, of the story. 2 Samuel 18:18. Absalom, in his lifetime, had taken and reared up for himself a pillar. Now, I won't read the rest of that. But there's memorials that people build for themselves so that others will remember them. And we actually see a lot of that that happens in even modern times. What about other kinds of memorials? Exodus 3, 14 and 15. This isn't a stone. This isn't a pillar. This isn't a thing. It is a person. It is God. The name of God. Exodus 3, 14 and 15. And God said unto Moses, "I am that I am." And he said, "Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you." And God said moreover unto Moses, "Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, hath sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations." The very name of God, Jehovah, I am, is a memorial, something to help them remember. Remember what? Remember that God is their God. The covenant God, Jehovah, the one who gave the promise to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, he is their God. And it's contained within his very name that he is their God. Exodus 12, 14. "And this day shall be unto you for a memorial, and you shall keep it a feast for the Lord throughout your generations. You shall keep it a feast by an ordinance forever." The Passover, we see it celebrated throughout Scripture, and we see it culminating in the life of Christ and his death, the fulfillment of the Passover. And this is a memorial. And even today, those of the Jewish faith continue to celebrate Passover as a memorial, even if falsely so, because the fulfillment of the Passover was seen in Jesus Christ. We go back again into Exodus 16, another memorial, the pot of manna. "And Moses said, this is the thing which the Lord commandeth, fill an omer of it to be kept for your generations, that they may see the bread wherewith I have fed you in the wilderness when I brought you forth from the land of Egypt. And Moses said unto Aaron, take a pot and put an omer full of manna therein and lay it up before the Lord to be kept for your generations. And the Lord commanded Moses, so Aaron laid it up before the testimony to be kept." This pot of manna is, this jar is filled, this omer of manna is put in a jar and it's placed in the Ark of the Covenant. And it's put there for what? A memorial. To remember what? God provides. God provides. The other two items, the table of the two tablets of stone of the Ten Commandments are in the Ark of the Covenant, and Aaron's rod that budded. All to remember what God has done. God has given you the law. God has chosen his people and his leaders, and specifically Aaron, as far as the rod that budded. And God provides for his people. Then we see over in Exodus 28, those two verses, 12 and 29. "Thou shalt put the two stones upon the shoulders of the ephod for stones of memorial unto the children of Israel, and Aaron shall bear their names before the Lord upon his two shoulders for a memorial. And Aaron shall bear the names of the children of Israel in the breastplate of judgment upon his heart, when he goeth in unto the holy place for a memorial before the Lord continually." When the high priest goes into the Holy of Holies, he is carrying with him the very names of the children of Israel, being representative of all of them. as he goes in to offer the blood on the Holy of Holies, the mercy seat of the Ark of the Covenant, and bearing those on the shoulder pieces and on the breastplate, the very names of the children of Israel, because it is they who are the object of that, the subject of that sacrifice, and God being the recipient of that sacrifice, the memorial, the remembrance of who that sacrifice is for. I didn't include these verses on a slide, but we see the other feasts, not just Passover, but all the feasts are for a memorial, for a remembrance of who God is, what he has done, and not only that, but for what he is going to do. A memorial for what God is promising to do. The Feast of Trumpets, the Day of Atonement, the Feast of Tabernacles, all of these are promises of something yet to come. God's promises yet to be fulfilled. And then we see memorials in the form of an altar in prophecy. Isaiah 19, this is a millennial prophecy. This happens in the thousand-year reign of Christ and the millennial kingdom here on earth. But it's an altar that will be built in Egypt. Not just the one in Jerusalem, but there's also an altar built in Egypt, a memorial of what God will do in the people of Egypt in that day. In that day, there shall be an altar to the Lord in the midst of the land of Egypt, and a pillar at the border thereof to the Lord. And it shall be for a sign and for a witness unto the Lord of hosts in the land of Egypt, for they shall cry unto the Lord because of the oppressors, and he shall send them a Savior and a great one, and he shall deliver them, and the Lord shall be known to Egypt. And the Egyptians shall know the Lord in that day. And this altar is erected in honor and memoriam of that event when Egypt turns to God. Throughout the Old Testament, we see time and time again where God calls upon his people to remember and giving them aids, giving them things to latch onto so that they can remember what God has done. Is it any different in the New Testament? No. We get to the New Testament, and even in early church days, we see in the catacombs of Rome, we see symbols. We see the cross. We see the fish. We see the anchor. We see these symbols drawn and carved on cave walls. I was in Jerusalem back in 2011, I think it was, and got to go into the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. You go down into one section, it's the Arminian section. And Arminian is up there in eastern Turkey and north of that. But it's the Arminian church of the first few centuries of the church had a tie to Mount Ararat and Noah. And so across the floor is a mosaic of Noah's Ark in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre that's probably close to 1,700 years old. And you see Crusader crosses carved into the columns. And these crosses were all symbols of and pointing back to the sacrifice of Christ on the cross. We see the fish, the ichthus, that's the Greek word for fish, which is an alliteration to Jesus Christ, God's Son, Savior, in the Greek letters. We see the anchor that passes from Hebrews, comparing Christ to an anchor. He is our anchor. We sing about that. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure, like the billows roll. We see this next picture. Bet you know what this stands for. An empty tomb. An empty tomb. We go on to the next. Baptism is a memorial to what? Let's read it. Romans 6. Know ye not that so many of us, as we're baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. When you're saved and you choose to follow the Lord in baptism, it is a symbol, it is a memorial, it is a reminder of what? What Christ did for you, and you're identifying with him in his death, in his burial, in his resurrection. Because in his resurrection, we have hope. We have hope. 1 Corinthians 15 says we have hope because he is risen, therefore we shall be also. And finally, probably the best known memorial that we have as Christians, 1 Corinthians 11. 24 through 26, the Lord's table, the Lord's supper. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." After the same manner, he also took the cup when he had supped, saying, "The cup is the New Testament, my blood, and this do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come." What is contained there? Again, a remembrance, a memorial, to remember what Christ has done for us. We look back through the Old Testament and we see, why are we calling all this stuff to remembrance? To remember what God has done for us. We get to the New Testament. Why do we do this? Why do we have baptism? Why do we have the Lord's Supper? So we can what? Remember what God has done for us. Over and over again, we see this is what God has done. It's a pounding insistence. The call to remember, repeated throughout Scripture. Remember that God called your father Abraham in his old age. He promised him children. He promised him a nation. He promised that they would be in bondage for 400 years in a foreign land, then freed by his divine power. And remember that God brought Israel to greatness, even though she was weak. Remember the commands of the Lord. Remember that the psalmist summed up this message. In 105:5, he says, "Remember his marvelous works that he has done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth." Those who forget. What's that saying? Those who forget the past are condemned to repeat it. Those who forget the past fall into thanklessness. It is unlikely that we could do any better than the Israelites. They needed help to remember. We need help to remember. When we celebrate Memorial Day, when we honor those that have fallen, we honor them because we are forgetful people. And we take things for granted. We celebrate the Lord's table because we need help remembering. We do these things to honor, to remember the sacrifice that has been made. Every culture, every country has its own memorials. Those best memorials lift our sights above the mundane affairs of the moment in order to focus our attention. Last Monday, our attention was focused on what? Those who gave their all. Those who gave their all. When we celebrate the Lord's Supper, our attention is focused on the one who gave his all in sacrifice for us and our eternal salvation. We visit monuments, we visit memorials, and it calls us and it causes us to remember the deeds of those individuals. It helps us to embrace more noble and lofty goals than would otherwise be possible for us. Sometimes those memorials can serve less than honorable purposes. Sometimes they call attention to a past that doesn't exist or is quite warped from what it was intended to be. We can look at that verse about Absalom. He built a memorial to himself. To honor who? Himself. Nebuchadnezzar did the same thing in Daniel chapter 6. He built a great gold statue of him. You can go to the Middle East right now, well, you used to be able to, and see a big statue of Saddam Hussein built by Saddam. You can go to Turkey right now, and their president Erdogan built a big gold statue of himself, just like Nebuchadnezzar. People build monuments and memorials to themselves. They can cast a favorable light upon themselves, even though it's a false light. But it's all looking on a false past with little hope for a new future. Hopeful memories do not drag us into the past, but give us hope into the future. Hope into the future. The prophets of old called upon God's people and told them to remember the works of the Lord and what he had done in the past as a way to prepare them for the hope of the future. They were not called upon to remember the past for its own sake. The practice was not a self-indulgent diversion. Rather, they were to remember the wonders of the past so that their lives would be open to the even greater wonders God would do for them in the future. The Lord's Supper is a hopeful memorial. It does not falsely glorify the past. When we partake of the bread and the cup, we remember the broken body and blood of the Lord. Images of deceit, betrayal, cruelty at the cross, those impose themselves upon us. But the Lord's Supper does so much more. It reminds us of the sacrificial love of God, and it speaks to us of God's love, God's forgiveness, God's sacrifice, God's grace, God's salvation, God's giving of hope for our future. The past and the future in the Lord's Supper are made into vital contemporary realities for us by the presence of Christ. The meal, the Lord's Supper, is a memorial that reinforces a hopeful memory, just as our Memorial Day last Monday. With that Memorial Day just being very recent in our memory, it's proper to think of the past and those who have given their all for our freedom and our future. For us Christians, it's also not an exercise in looking behind and dwelling upon what has been, for we believe that more wondrous things are yet to come. And that is our hope and what we look forward to. As people of faith, we look forward to the wonders and the promises of Jesus Christ, because these things do show the Lord's death until when? Until he comes. We live in the light of the resurrection. That's another memorial that I hadn't even mentioned. The fact that we meet here every Sunday is a testament to what? We serve a risen Lord who rose on the first day of the week. And here we are every Sunday. We live in the light of that resurrection, and we believe that death will not be the end. As Christ died for us and secured our freedom, as our heroes in war have died in battle to secure our freedom, all of that is to give us hope into the future. We live in the light of his resurrection. Let's close in prayer. Father, we just thank you again for what you have done for us. Lord, we thank you, of course, for those in our country who have paid the ultimate price, sacrificing themselves for our freedom. Lord, we do not take that lightly, and we thank you for days that we have that we can remember. Remember what they have done for us, and remember what you have done for us. Lord, just thank you. We praise you. Lord, just take us away from here this evening and for this evening and bring us back, Lord, and prepared to hear your word again tonight. Lord, just guide and direct us now as we go home. Thank you for all that you have done for us, Lord. In Christ's name we ask it. Let's go ahead and stand this morning. This is not an invitation, but I want to sing this song again, not all four verses. I want to sing the first and the last verse. As we think about the memorial, that is Memorial Day, that is our worship here, the memorial of what God has done for us, and a memorial of what God has done for this country. We look at the words on some of these hymns. That's what is so striking to me. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride. Let freedom ring. And then that last verse as well. Let's close with these two verses and we'll be dismissed.